All right, morning. Today I'm going to be talking to you about building over or near relevant infrastructure. So things like your sewer mains, your water mains and stormwater and all that. So just a bit of background first. The main guiding document we have in Queensland is MP1.4, building over or near relevant infrastructure. So MP1.4 is a mandatory part of the QDC, the Queensland Development Code. And where that varies from the BCA, the QDC, you actually have to abide by the QDC. So that's why this MP1.4 is applicable in Queensland. So MP1.4 provides kind of acceptable, deemed to comply type solutions. And they may vary a little bit depending on your certifier, but it's overall pretty good guidelines. And it's all aimed at kind of protecting the infrastructure from being loaded by your building and also allowing access for maintenance of that infrastructure, those services, and protecting your building from subsidence, because where these services are backfilled, it's usually not compacted very well, so that can settle and cause damage to buildings that are close by. So MP1.4, like I said, has a couple kind of deemed to comply type solutions, and that's for your class 1 and 10 buildings. And then they also stretch the limits or give you extra tolerances for class 10 lightweight buildings. And then where you kind of fall outside their recommendations, you have to use alternate solutions. So that's for like your class 2 to 9 buildings, pressure pipelines, and when you're working with large pipes in the ground. So there's two main performance requirements. There's P1, that's all to do with keeping your building from loading that infrastructure and causing damage to it. And then P2 is mainly about allowing that access for the services and for maintenance and whatnot. So I'll jump into the acceptable solution requirements for P1, so not kind of loading that service and keeping everything structurally sound. So I guess the main thing here is you don't want your building to load that pipe that's in the ground. So the footings of your building, you want them to be found deep enough so that this 45 degree spread or this zone of influence that your building has kind of that your building's exerting into the earth falls below that service, whether it's water main, stormwater or sewer. So MP1.4 says that your zone of influence has to fall 300 below that pipe, and that's just giving you a bit of extra tolerance. So there are cases, like not always you can have your footings, say an edge beam for a raft slab can't always be deep enough that it's not gonna kind of affect that sewer. So the way around that is by adding piles underneath those building footings so that it's found deep enough so it doesn't kind of have any influence over where those services are. The only limitation with that is your board piers, if you choose to do them, they have to be 1.2 meters clear of the center line of the service. And that's just because the way the board piers are done, you kind of send in the rig and it digs down and you don't even know if you've hit the service before you've kind of chewed through the whole pipe. So that's the reason they have that extra clearance for that one. So you also have to have a meter clearance from any connections that jump up from the main from the main pipe. That's in kind of a spherical type clear zone where you don't want to be impacting anything in there. And then there's also a general rule of thumb where you can't do any excavation within 600 mils of the outer wall of your service. Most of the pipes, I think, tend to work out as 150 diameter, so you end up with kind of a 1350 clear zone where you want to avoid excavating in there. And then there's also a couple other extra rules, like avoiding compaction and vibration within 2 meters of the center line of your infrastructure that's in the ground. Don't want that to be affecting it, and And then you also have a limit on the amount of fill that you can place over these services that are in the ground. So you're actually not meant to put more than a meter worth of fill over this over your infrastructure. However, you can do so if it's for a retaining wall, where the retaining wall has a bridging system designed in its footing so that the loading is directed kind of over and away from this sewer or stormwater pipe or water main, so that you're not actually loading it with this extra fill that's going on. So they were what you need to satisfy to achieve those P1 requirements. So these P2 ones for allowing maintenance have a couple requirements as well. One of which is providing 1.5 meters wide by 2.4 meters high clear zone along the line of your infrastructure, and that's just to allow them to get whatever they need to get in to maintain this infrastructure. Also, where if you have any maintenance covers, you need 1.5 meter radius, infinitely high. You need that to be a clear zone to allow for maintenance in those situations. And then, like I mentioned earlier, there's a few extra kind of tolerances for lightweight class 10 buildings. So in MP1.4, they define lightweight class 10 as your class 10 building, say a carport, shed, anything like that, that contains no masonry in it. So when you have one of these class buildings, you can get away with having it over your infrastructure as long as it doesn't continuously land over it for more than 10 meters. You still have to provide clear zones for maintenance. So 1.5 meter radius times infinite height over any maintenance cover like before. The only difference is with the connection points. See, in this little diagram, you have connection point coming in near the carport. So you'd actually need a 1 meter radius by 2.4 meters high clear zone directly above that connection point from ground level up. So a lot of these requirements are to try and fit into your just like deemed to comply type solutions. But they can vary depending what certifier you have, and sometimes you don't have an option. So it's always good to keep your certifier in the loop to see what they're happy with. So I'm gonna give a few examples of jobs that I've come across here at Cornell Engineers that have involved infrastructure nearby our buildings. So this was a double-story new residence going on steel columns and concrete footings. So you can see there's a sewer out near this last row of footings. And because our footings fell so close to this sewer, we couldn't just use your standard board pier solution. So you can see here, we've still got our 1350 wide exclusion zone where you can't do any excavation because that's 600 out from that wall. But then once we've gone past that, we've proposed to use pad footings, backhoe pads. And the idea behind that is you kind of scoop it out layer by layer. So it's not like a board pier where you drill down and you don't even know what you've hit until you kind of pull the rig out. So that's what we propose, having these pad footings within that 1.2 meter zone, but still outside the 600 mil clear zone. And you can see from the cross section as well, making sure we're founding 300 below that zone of influence. In this situation, it came down to the certifier once again. Like I said, so he wasn't very happy with that one, and it just ended up being easier to move things around. So the architect shifted the building a little bit, and we were able to bring in our footings. So we were 1.2 meters clear of that center line, and we could just use your standard board pier solution. And you can see from the cross section, they'll be definitely found deeper than the zone of influence of that sewer. So this was a little carport job. This is a good example of that clear zone over the connection point, which is your 1 meter radius and 2.4 meters high. So you can see we've kind of stepped in the footing around that connection, and also brought in the column that was supporting the roof beam of that carport, and then the roof beam can cantilever over because it's above that 2.4 meters high clear zone. So this allows for us to put in a removable kind of topping slab, which some certifiers like to do around these types of connection points, just so, easy access for if they ever need to do any maintenance around that area. This was an interesting one I found where the sewer line kind of ran directly in line with an edge beam of a raft slab that was going in, and so there was no real way around that one other than doing the RPEQ designed bridging system. So you can see in the cross section we've got that edge beam being supported by concrete bridging beams, which are then which span onto board piers either side of this sewer, the board piers of course being 1.2 meters clear of the center line of that sewer, and then all your load is directed out and around and down past that zone of influence. So that was the solution, I guess, that we ended up going with on this one. So yeah, that's my little rundown of MP1.4 and how to apply it.